all over the world, man.
Australia, China, same Africa,
old shit everywhere
England.
I go,
you know.
Why does everybody's story seem to sound the same?
They don't seem so familiar.
Struggle in the game.
They don't seem so familiar.
You left the hood for change.
Welcome to Off The Record. I'm your man Whanie Lewis, and today in the studio we have a very special guest, someone that's well known in Port Elizabeth, even in South Africa, Eon Le Roux. And he is, it was a contestant on The Voice South Africa, and I think he went very, very far. Just check out how far he got. Hi, welcome to the show, Eon.
Uncle Whanie, thanks for having me.
It's nice to have you here, man. It's nice to have a famous person in studio with us, talking to us about your life. And it's a very big privilege for us to have you on the show.
Thanks so much for having me. It's awesome to be here.
Is it? Great.
Definitely, definitely.
So tell us, we don't know much about you except that you were on TV and you are a singer and you do very good with your career. Tell us about, who is Eon Le Roux?
I am a child of four. I've got three siblings, two brothers and one sister. My dad was a pastor, and my mom is a nurse. And I think in 2009, my dad passed away in a tragic car accident.
Famous.
So we've been living all over South Africa. So I was born in East London.
In the East of
Exactly. I was born in East London, and then from there we moved to Malmesbury, just Cape outside of Cape Town, yes. And then from Malmesbury we came to Port Elizabeth, which is the greatest city in the world. Please listen to me. Don't come. I don't want you guys to come to PE. Please don't come to PE. Just visit and then you can go, because this is the greatest city.
It's actually running from my ear. I'm with you. Okay, so you were very tight with your brothers and your family, right?
Yes, yes. So we grew up together, and how we actually got influenced with the music side of things and singing, especially me. So my mom, at a very young age, I don't know if you guys are the same and your parents were the same, but any auntie or oom that comes to visit there at our house, she would say, okay, all four of you stand in a row and you're gonna sing to the aunties and the uncles. So that was the you understand?
Yeah.
So that was the first kind of, you know, experience for me. And at that point I hated music. Absolutely. Or singing, not music. I hated singing because I was forced to sing by my mother, and it was, you know, it's mostly nice, man. Understand?
Yeah.
You want to be free. Understand? You really have force me.
Exactly.
Singing.
So,
exactly. So that was quite an experience for me, and then I hated singing. But then as time went on, so my dad, like I said, my dad was a pastor. And he would give us the opportunity to kind of sing to the congregations where he would go and minister at. And for me, what sparked the relationship with music was when I saw how music touched people and how they were inspired by the message through song. Because my dad was a very powerful preacher. And so for me to kind of compare myself, you know, I'm not a powerful preacher. I don't have that gift. But what I realized, the gift that I had was singing and inspiring people through singing and through music. And that was the relationship that started, or that sparked the relationship between music and my passion for music. That's what happened. When I could see people saying, you really, you know, you touched me this morning, or wherever we would go and sing, they would say, you know, you really inspired me, touched me. I'm going through a difficult situation, circumstance in my life, but the song that you sang really encouraged me. And that's where it all started for me with music.
Yeah. You're not only singing secular music, you are actually in a gospel group as well.
That's wow. It's actually a sad story. And my brother's gonna cry if he sees this thing. Please don't cry, Stanley. My brother. So we were in a gospel group. I was in a gospel group up until I entered the Voice of South Africa. And that is when the separation happened. So it's a very sad story.
Yeah, it is, man. Because you guys were quite good in engaging with people. Because yes. I actually followed you guys.
Oh wow!
Yeah, and I like the way you guys actually jaw with people, and the standard of music and the presentness that you gave people. That's what I like.
Sure, thank you so much.
Anyone can sing gospel. Yeah. And dance to the beat, yeah. But you have to bring a quality message out there.
Definitely.
Your body language and your lifestyle must also show it. Yes. And that's what I like about you guys.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank
this you is going much. For a short break. When we come back, we continue the conversation with Eon Le Roux, Mr. PE. Welcome back to Off the Record. My name is Whanie Lewis, and today in studio we sit with a very special guest, Mr. Eon Le Roux. He was on The Voice South Africa, so you know him definitely if you watch The Voice. He made a great impact, so today we talk about his lifestyle, where he grew up, and what's next in his life. Eon, your father was a leader, and he was a pastor, and he pastored a lot of people out of their problems and changed their minds, because that's what he's pastoring about. You can't just preach to people, because you get people from the streets that is very empty and damaged and broken. So that's a healing center when you come to a pastor. So we had a very big influence on people. You want to tell us about how do you value him?
So yeah, like you said, my dad was a pastor and also influenced a lot of people, including myself, because he was a man of God, not just by his words, but by his lifestyle as well, the way he would live. And so the one thing that, you know, growing up as a young boy, that my dad instilled in us was family worship. Mm. He would always say that a family that prays together stays together. And every morning at about 7 a.m., we would get up as a family. He would come and wake us up 7 o'clock in the morning. And we would get together and we would have some family worship. And then in the evening at 7 o'clock as well, we would get together, sing songs together, and worship together as a family. And at times, our family worship sessions would last like 3 hours.
Wow.
Just singing and, you know, just worshiping and praising God.
You wasn't forced to sing that time.
No, that was the best. I think they were, you know, as time went on, when that relationship sparked with music, then I think my family became a little irritated by me because now I'm just singing all the time. And I was like, oh, Opsum, you sing the field now, what? I said, it's your fault, mommy. You forced me to sing. Yeah. And now, but no bias song and then.
That's the problem.
So, exactly. So that's your fault. It's all on you. But yeah, so that was the kind of man that he was. So I think he would also say charity begins at home. Mm. So the principles and the values that you instill in your family then infiltrates and penetrates the community.
Yeah.
Because you can't want to try and change the community if your family, if you can't even, you know, affect your family or influence your family.
Yeah.
So that was the kind of man that he was.
Yeah.
He would build on the foundations and the principles and the values of us and try and influence us in a positive way.
Yeah.
And see how we then go into the community and, you know, the world around us outside of our little bubble home that we have, and try and impact that because of the values and the principles that both my mom and my dad, you know, instilled in us.
Mm.
So that was the kind of man that he was. And to the people, you know, in church, in the congregation, he would be the same, same person, very fair, and also an amazing person to, you know, counselor to kind of people. A lot of people would go to him with, you know, their different problems and challenges that they have. That was the kind of person and the influence he had in our home and the community at large as well.
How was your relationship with your mom? Your father and your mom?
Absolutely amazing. You will not believe me if I say this. I've never seen my mom and my dad shout at each other or fight each other. That's fantastic. That's fantastic. And that's the kind of, you know, the influence as a man, you know, or let me rather say as a boy looking looking at your dad, how he would treat my mom.
Yeah.
Very, you know, he was very gentle. He was never rude. He was never disrespectful to her. And that was the example that I had growing up as a man.
Yeah.
So my place then in society and the community, I would know how to treat a woman, how to speak and not be disrespectful. Because those are the principles and the values that I was exposed to because of my dad and my mom.
Yeah. How long were they married?
I think they were married for about 35 years, if I'm not mistaken. 35 years?
35 years.
Yeah, 35 years. And so the experience that they shared with us, and a lot of times, you know, when we go to, when they have like counseling with couples and so on, they would share a story that they had when they got married. They said, this is their story. I don't know how true this is, but this is what they said. When they got married, they had one big fight. But it wasn't like a shouting or kind of fight. It was just a disagreement. And so they said they would never want to experience that again. And they worked at, you know, if there's disagreements, they would listen to each other and then basically just discuss. Not that I'm saying that they have never disagreed about anything, but just the way they handled the situation.
Exactly.
It wasn't a, ek is nou kwaad vir jou, ek wil jou slaan of
praat nie nie.
Understand? It's just we don't see eye to eye. That's your view. This is my view.
Yeah.
Let's see where we can make a compromise and come together and move forward. So that was the kind of relationship that my dad, you know, had with my mom.
Yeah.
So
that's actually a great example of how to be in a marriage.
Definitely.
Because we dachten daar misschien bij een Mickey Mouse marriage.
Yeah. Oh, yesterday.
Your father went away. He was in an accident, terrible accident, you said. Right?
Yes.
So how was the pain that you experienced at the time?
You know what? It is very difficult to describe because I don't think, like I say to a lot of people, the pain is not so much in losing my dad.
Mm.
The pain is more in seeing my mom be without my dad.
Wow.
because they were very close. My dad was my mom's first boyfriend. So you can imagine, you know, her first love, her only love, is now gone. I think I was 18 years old when he died. The problem for me was, or at least the pain and the struggle was, like listening and watching my mom cry herself to sleep and wake up crying. So as a young boy, there's absolutely nothing you can do.
Sure.
And all that I know how to do is pray and ask God, you know, just be with her, just comfort her, just hold her heart, just make things okay.
Yeah.
And that was the toughest thing for me. Losing my dad was just seeing my mom in that state is absolutely devastating.
Were you guys like teenagers or youngsters at the time?
So I was 19 years old, oh, 18 years old, when he died.
So you were actually in your final year in school?
I was in my first year university.
University, yeah. Also very important.
My eldest brother, he was married. My sister was, I think she was also out of the house. And my elder brother, he was married as well. And out of the house. Or I think, I'm not even sure. I can't even remember how far old.
Now I understand the pain your mom must be feeling. Because everybody is like not there anymore.
Yes.
Everybody
so,
had their own lives.
Exactly. Exactly. So no. that was something that, you know, was really also painful to her, was the fact that it's just me and her, you know, and everybody's moved on. And the fear and the anxiety that she has is, I am also going to leave.
Yeah.
So all of those emotions at one, you know, just bombarding you and it's
and you had to like step up. Because you need to be the guy in the house.
Exactly. So it was really something that, honestly speaking, I don't know how I got through it, because I just had to shake off, you know, and just be that guy and have that the heart to kind of work through my emotions as well as support my mom and just push forward, because we can't. And my dad would say, time waits for no man. And I didn't understand that saying as much as I did when it happened, when my father passed, because the family would come. And the family was there to support my mom, and she felt so supported. She felt so, you know, comforted by the family. And it was really something, a great thing to see, of the family coming together. But time waits for no man.
Exactly.
Time goes on. The family needs to go back home, and everybody needs to go back to their own lives. And that's when, you know, reality kicked in, and then things just started getting real. And here is my mom, she's still mourning, life is going on, everybody needs to go back to work, to school, to, you know, it just needs to keep going, it needs to keep going. So that's when I understood that time waits for no man.
For no one,
Time waits for no man. And that's just how things go. You just need to keep going, keep pushing through, and keep believing, keep just, you know, reminding yourself of the promises and reminding yourself who you are in that devastating experience.
It's going to take a short break. When we come back, we continue the conversation with Mr. Eon Le Roux.
Want jy skrik, jy is 13 jaar getroud met die man, wat het dan intussen verkeerd geloop, waar het jy verkeerd gegaan? Sy sê vir my, nee, sy is swanger vir die derde keer. Nou skrik ek.
Vir die derde keer?
wie 'n swanger vra.
Hi guys, don't forget to watch Relationship Status with me, Larissa Savage, every Sunday at 3 PM on our YouTube channel, Foolproof TV. Don't forget to like and subscribe.
Welcome back to Off The Record. My name is Whanie Lewis. I'm sitting today in studio with Mr. Eon Le Roux, a contestant on The Voice, and he's talking to us about his lifestyle and what's next in his life. Eon, hoekom het jy The Voice toe gegaan?
Uncle Whanie, that's a very good question.
You don't say Uncle Whanie.
I did say so.
Okay.
Don't worry, I call everybody uncle and auntie. Some people get upset, but it's just my way of...
I'll just laugh about it.
So going to The Voice essay, I've always wanted to enter The Voice essay since it started. You know, obviously seeing America's one and, you know, all the ones overseas, it was always a dream of mine to be part of such a competition.
Yeah.
And when it started, the first season, I actually entered The Voice essay, but I didn't, I don't know what happened, but there wasn't any response regarding, you know, my entry. And then I saw the auditions up on the website, on The Voice essay, I think it was the Facebook page.
Yeah.
It said, you can enter The Voice essay. And I thought about entering, but at the same time, I didn't feel that I was good enough to be part of the show.
Yeah.
And so a good friend of mine said to me, he also saw, you know, the entries are available, or you can audition on the Facebook page. And he said to me, Eon, why don't you enter The Voice essay? So I was like, you know what? I really want to, but I don't think it's a good idea, because I don't feel good enough to be, you know, to be part of the competition, because, I mean, it's The Voice essay, come on.
That's
come
the biggest stage.
Verstaan? So he said, listen, if there's one thing I can tell you, is that I believe you belong on the biggest stage in South Africa. So I said, you know what? I'm gonna give it a shot.
Yeah.
And I entered The Voice. And I still didn't feel, you know, good enough to be on or part of the competition. And got feedback eventually, and then made it to...
How'd you feel?
It was a fantastic feeling. It was absolutely amazing. Because you know what? Honestly, I didn't expect it.
Yeah.
I was just like...
Because you doubted yourself.
Exactly. I was just like, listen, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. It's really, I'm not going to be disappointed if it doesn't happen. And you won't believe me, the day that that they sent out the emails to say that you made it into, you know, the blind audition of The Voice essay, they sent out emails saying, or let me rather say this, I received an email. It was a Monday evening. I remember it as if it was yesterday. It was a Monday evening. I was walking and I received a notification. The Voice essay just sent you an email. And I opened the email and the email said, unfortunately, you didn't make it into the show. And then I said, okay, this is... I'm not disappointed.
Like, it is disappointing.
Honestly, my mindset the whole time was, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't.
Yeah.
So I was just thinking, at the time when I read it, I said to myself, okay, so this means this is not for me. So I'm just gonna move on. And I think it was an hour or two later, I was chatting to the same friend of mine. I was telling him, listen, unfortunately, I didn't make it in. They sent me an email. So he was upset. He was absolutely upset. And I said to him,
why took a fellow brief as
And then I said to him, you know what, I'm not disappointed because I know it's not meant to be.
Yeah.
If it was meant to be, I would make it in.
Yeah.
And he was like, you know what, Eon, I see your mindset, I see your attitude, and I totally agree with you. And as I was on the phone, you know, having this conversation with him, I received another notification from the voice essay. And I opened the email while I was on the phone with him.
Yeah.
And it said there, please disregard the first email that you got. You actually made it into the voice essay. And then I was like, oh my goodness. This is awesome.
Yeah, man.
And I arrived at the voice essay, and it was absolutely an amazing experience.
Is it the same thing that we see on TV?
Definitely not. Oh, 100% not. It's not the same at all.
Yeah.
So when we, when I arrived there, we were about 96 people that auditioned for the blind, what they call the blind audition.
Yeah, where they turn around and
yes,
see.
Yes, that's correct. Okay. So they said over 3,000 people entered the competition. 3,000 and only 96 made it to the blind audition, to the coaches and all of those things. Anyways, and so you can imagine it's 96 people that's walking around, that's singing, that's rehearsing, and it's not idols where you have people who made it in who can't really sing, you know, they want to make spy of the man, so now it's singers,
it's
musicians, it's strong musicians who sing well. So now you can imagine how overwhelming it is for everybody to be in a room with people who sing amazingly.
Exactly.
And who are talented.
Yeah.
Like musicians, guitarists, everybody, all of them. You just sit in the room and this one sings and you're like, oh my word, is that what I'm actually, you know, up against?
Yeah.
And then the next person sings and you're like, oh my word, what is happening? And this and that. And then it's like, okay, maybe this was a bad idea. maybe it's not meant to be. Maybe it was just like, you know, just make it there to the blind audition and let's go home. Yay, it was great to be here, guys.
I was the first time when you get on the stage.
Like I said, it was overwhelming. And it was really, so that voice that I had in the beginning saying that you are not good enough was there. Every single day, every minute, every second, it was there saying, dude, what are you doing?
Yeah.
What are you doing here? Look at this, look at that person, look at this person. Yeah. You don't belong here. What's wrong with you? Understand? Yesterday. So I'm just like, oh my word, I don't think we're gonna last. And
what's the competition that tough? I'm not gonna die.
Listen. I'm telling you, that was the competition.
Sure.
Because what happens is you don't get a chance to hear everybody sing.
Yeah.
But there's an opportunity where you basically either go to a vocal coach or there's a rehearsal space where each contestant has an opportunity to rehearse their song. So then this person breaks out in song and now you're sitting there listening to this person, there's people, even the other contestants sitting, listening to that person singing.
Yeah.
It's like, hulle mond gaan oop.
Yeah.
And hulle staan daar, and hulle kyk, and ons kyk mekaar, and we like,
what? Ja, okay, ook we gaan iemand mond oop. Verstaan?
It's just every single time, every time it happens. And so that was the experience I had. So going onto stage, that was the mentality I had.
Yeah.
Was like, there's so many talented people here. Yeah. I don't stand a chance. So walking onto the stage, that was what I was thinking. Dude, if it happens, it happens. You're not good enough to be here. It's fine. It's all good. You know, there's no hope in getting your hopes up.
Yeah.
So, or let me rather say, there's no point in getting your hopes up because look at the competition. You don't belong here. It's over. And so that was what I was thinking, and I was walking onto stage, and then so. The reason why I chose the song I sang on my blind audition was because of the mindset that I had and of myself, which was I didn't really believe in my gift, that I call it a gift because I believe it's a gift that I've been given.
Tell us the song,
Feeling Good by Nina Simone. And you know, in the past, things just never happened. It was never going right. I tried music so many times and things just never panned out. It was never, it just never happened. It was just every time I try and things go wrong, or, you know, it's just you put all your hopes and your dreams in this one little thing and then, it just disappears. So, anyways, and at that particular time, I had that mindset of, you know, I don't think I'm good enough, but I believe in the gift that I've been given.
Exactly.
So if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't.
But to drive this too long.
And so at that moment, I realized, wow, this is a new day, a new life.
And that is actually the performance that I can like this video. It's a new day. Kijk, allemaal dit, allemaal echt goed, quai songs, DJ. Ik praat dus Donald Trump. Dat zijn quai songs gezongen, en dit nice performances gegeven. But die, this is a new day. Yes. It's for me, like, uitgestaan, because why? It's like the way you do it, man. It's like there's X behind it. Ik wil net voor die kijkers die video speel. Kom eens kijken op je screen.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. In the sky, you know how I feel. A breeze drifting by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
Say is amazing grace, how sweet the sound. I once was lost, but found. And I stand here asking you to choose me.
I'm gonna go with Ricky Rick.
Hoe's het daar gevoel?
Ja. It was a confirmation for me. Because that clip doesn't show, I don't know if you watched the show. Mm. It doesn't show what happened and why I chose Ricky Rick. Mm. So as soon as I was done singing, Ricky Rick said to me, when you started out, it seems as if you were saying to yourself, yeah, you're not good enough. Mm. And that's exactly how I felt.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he said, as the song went on and it got to the power section, mm, you were saying, I am good enough.
Wow.
And so he said, I want you to know from this moment going forward that you are good enough.
No.
To be on the stage, and you are good enough as a musician, as an artist, and I want you to know that.
Mm.
And that was it for me.
Yeah. the song alone, I speak so for good.
Yes.
And a new day. It's a very deep message.
Definitely.
When you say it's a new day, you actually they prophesy.
Yes.
Where you're like, new things is happening.
Yes.
It's like good morning. The meaning of good morning is, yes, very powerful.
Definitely.
Means good morning, but take it, yeah, good morning. But it actually speak of new beginnings, new life, new love, new everything.
Yes.
And to learn na yung tukom is a song feel. Song ay inike kaya. I mean, that's what as what for you bedoel was.
Yes.
Everything was like meant for you.
Definitely.
I mean, ni by music ay die treatment. On the voice,
yes.
En allemaal die stoelen draaien om.
Yeah.
En die mensen gaan nou. Hij was 4 judges, right?
Yes, 4 judges, yeah. 4 coaches, as they would say. And then obviously, the person that I actually wanted to turn was Rihanna now.
Yeah.
The reason being is she's in the gospel industry.
Yeah.
And she's very, very well known and Afrikaans gospel, but I mean still, yeah, you know, gospel. And she's a very spiritual person.
Yeah.
And she's absolutely amazing, man. She's really so when she didn't turn, my heart just, you know, kind of broke me a little bit.
Yeah.
But then it was also confirmation to what I was feeling and what I was thinking.
Yeah, with Ricky.
Yes. And then he said that, and that's when I knew.
Yeah.
Wow, man, this is God. This is the opportunity.
Yeah.
And it's just moving forward from here.
Today now in the top 5 come.
Yes.
And ala kon na the top 4 an. Mm. How did you feel like when they didn't call your name?
You know what? Honestly speaking, I knew that was the end. Mm. I knew that I wasn't going to be I wasn't going to win.
Yeah.
Let me put it that way. Well, I felt like that every, you know, every Sunday for the live shows. I would, my mother would call me, you know, Eon, how are you feeling? And I'm like, mommy, just prepare. I'm coming home this week. Just get prepared, you know, prepare yourself. I'm already preparing myself. I'm coming home. So I was just like, yeah, man. And she's like, no, don't be so negative. So I'm like, mommy, just prepare yourself. Don't still say it's a negative. It's not being negative. It's being realistic. So I knew that every week, and then I would be surprised every week. It would be like, Eon, you're safe. I'm like, really? Yeah. I didn't know. All the people voting, I don't even know.
So
I
like it looks like you're like during the week.
Nothing.
A lot of stress on the pie.
You know what I think is really the most I don't want to be too harsh with my words, but I think the most stressful thing, let me put it that way. Yeah. The most stressful thing is what they say is just prepare yourself to go home. Mm. Nobody's safe. Yeah. That's what they would say. Nobody's safe. So you just prepare yourself to go home. But also in the back of your mind, have the hope that you would stay. So they would all remind us constantly, listen, it's a numbers game.
Yeah.
So it's not about who's the best and who's not the best and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
It's about who the viewer wants to see and who the person votes for. So for the viewers and the audience votes for. For me, that was like, how do you say that to someone? You understand what I'm saying? Prepare yourself. Every week, you're going home.
Yeah.
But my mindset was already, listen, I'm going home.
Yeah.
You don't have to tell us every week,
yeah,
listen, guys, all of you are not safe. So just prepare to go. I'm like, yeah, it's me. It's me. Don't worry, it's me. And then I'm just like, okay, Eon, it's enough. We heard enough now. Every week is the same story. And I'm just like, yeah, no, I know it's me. It's fine. Don't worry. Thank you for the opportunity. So that was my experience. And but yes, the top five, I never expected to get to the top five.
Yeah.
That was never my expectation. It was just a blessing for me to make it through, you know, the next round and the next round and the next round.
Mm.
And I never expected to reach the finals. And the top five, and when I got to the top five, I knew that this was, you know, my time has come to an end.
Yeah.
And the experience has been amazing.
Yeah.
I've learned so much meeting people in the industry, you know, veterans in the industry.
Yeah.
I mean, all of them are absolutely, you know, experienced and amazing at what they do. So they've built their careers, successful musicians.
Mm.
So it was just a blessing for me to learn from them, how they think, what their process is, how do you then attack, you know, being someone who's now inexperienced in the industry.
Yeah.
This is now the opportunity for you to step out into the world as a musician. What is the next step? How do you do what you do?
Yeah.
What is the knowledge that you have that you can share that I can, you know, just soak in and apply to my life?
True.
So that was my experience, especially at the end, the finale, was just, I need to get all the information that I possibly can.
Yeah, exactly.
Because this is the time to kind of learn. So that was how that finale period went.
Your life after The Voice, you traveled South Africa.
Yes.
And you did a lot of stuff. Tell us about that. How was that experience like being with like top artists?
Sure. The experience outside The Voice, absolutely amazing. It was an opportunity for me to see how, because I've never been exposed to that lifestyle, you know, in terms of traveling, always on the move, never at home for too long, because it would be Cape Town, Joburg.
No working hours. Work all day.
So that was a definitely something new and exciting, because it's, you know, it's always nice to travel. I mean, you know about traveling, so it's always nice to travel and to, you know, see different parts of the country and places. So that was the most exciting for me, was the traveling. And then singing alongside, I don't know if you know Unati.
Yeah.
I got the opportunity to sing alongside her. And that was also absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
To meet her, she's an absolutely amazing person.
Mm.
Full of laughter and just a joyful person. So it was really, I never expected to be that busy, because I don't know who I was chatting to the other day, and they asked me the same question, and I said to them, you know what, at The Voice, the finale, everybody around me, all the contestants, other contestants, were getting phone calls. They were, you know, they were really...
They were booked.
They were booked. And I'm sitting with my phone, I'm looking at my phone, and I'm like,
Not even a WhatsApp.
Not even a please call me Nux. And I'm just like, yesterday, this is a sad business day. This is a yesterday, oh, dear Samuel.
Like, okay.
And I'm thinking to myself, yesterday, all this way for nothing, man. Yeah, it's gonna be droog. You're gonna
have your photo
Yeah, I can check. I'm like, okay, flight mode set on. No steals next. But anyways, and then I landed in PE, and the funniest thing happened. So as I landed, I was waiting for my mom to fetch me from the airport, and Iman Raifa Bay. They didn't, I don't know if they saw me or what. I let my net a defense the right screen. I voted for you. So I said, thank you so much.
Oh man.
And it was by a man so that, you know, that were, you know, like welcoming and saying, Eon, you did so well. And so the support, you know, especially from PE, from the place where you come from, it was really amazing. And then as time went on, I started getting phone calls, and then it was just like, Eon, you know, you're from PE, we want to support you, and you know, we want to actually show the people how far you came, and you know, and PE as a city can be proud of the talent that, you know, that we have in, in the city. So that was quite
amazing for you.
Yes, it was a warm, fuzzy feeling, because you know the support that you have. Because we are not exposed to anybody, to any person who would say, listen, I supported you, or I voted for you, or this or that, the other. But then coming to you know, my hometown, where the support was just overwhelming. Everybody said, I voted for you, you were great, and this and that and the other. And then people started calling me, so I felt okay. It wasn't so maybe it was flight mode.
So after the yellow experience of this Wuntan gig show and all that, and they couldn't know me any because it's COVID and restrictions.
Yes.
Who affect that yellow mafia?
Yeah, I know. It's really been tough. Because one misses the audience. As a musician, the live audience atmosphere.
Yeah.
So there's some virtual gigs, you know, online, but means you know for your farm to sing. Because I believe that being a musician, you need to be an entrepreneur. Being an entrepreneur.
Yeah, you have to think.
Because it's your business.
Yeah.
And it's your own business. Yeah. So like I said, the networks and the people that I met on The Voice were really supportive, man. And the relationships that I built there, Auntie Rihanna now, as I call her, she was really great. And because I asked her, like, how are you, you know, adapting to the circumstances?
Yeah.
Because I mean, she's absolutely successful in her career.
Yeah.
So what is she, what are you doing differently to how you were doing things, you know, in the past? So she said, well, it's virtual. Mm. So we just have concerts online and do things online.
Adapt with the time.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So that was, you know, that was the mentality and the mindset. So that changed, and that, you know, that was my adaptation to the times. But you still, you know, you still want to have that live audience and interacting with the people, and chatting with the people, and that's something that one really misses. It is really a tough transition, because not everybody in South Africa has the internet or has the resources
or comfortable even
with
internet.
Exactly.
But I think it forced us in that
definitely. Like 100%.
The world was shifting to it, but took too long. So COVID came and he pushes us. So we don't have a choice. We have to do it.
Definitely.
So what's next for you, Mr. Eon?
So I recently released a song with a producer from Russia.
I saw that in the news.
And it was really something that I never expected would happen. It was just something that actually happened, an opportunity that came, you know, knocking. So this guy reached out to me on Instagram, just sent me a message. And he said, listen, I saw a couple of your videos and I like the way you sing, your style.
Yeah.
And can we, you know, would it be possible to collaborate together on a project? So I was like, and he sent through the song, and immediately when I heard the song, I was like, this is absolutely amazing. And I love new challenges, man. Something that challenges me to help me grow as a musician. And this was an opportunity for me to grow, because it's something that I'm not really used to. You know, it's not my style, really.
Yeah.
But
Lamplight.
Definitely. And so it was really something different. Yeah. But I also believe in whatever you put out, it needs to have a positive message. So the song that we did together is based on a perspective where a person is in an abusive relationship, and basically gender-based violence. And it is sometimes, and most people who are in these relationships, they believe that there's no solution to this situation unless now in it, and there's nothing that they can do about their situation. Allah Salmane Davies, and experience that abuse and that devastating, because it is a destructive environment for them, man. So this was the idea, to kind of write something to encourage those people and empower those people to take back that power that they felt they lost. And to also find the courage to walk away and to live their lives.
Wow.
So the song is called Walk Away.
Walk Away.
And
is this song on iTunes?
Yes, the song is on iTunes, the song, all digital platforms.
Okay.
So people can go and have a listen and check it out.
Wow, man. So, wow. Eon, I want to thank you for coming to the show.
Thanks so much.
And tell us about your life story. Not everybody's comfortable doing this. So thank you so much for coming out and just be you and tell us about your life.
Thank you so much, Uncle Whanie, for having me. Really appreciate it.
This is Eon Le Roux. My name is Whanie Lewis, and you're watching Off the Backbone.